أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
ويقول الذين We stopped at 26, 27. Allahu yabsutu or wa yaqulu alladhina. The number comes after the ayah. Finish at 26, okay.
A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytani al-wajim. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ويقول الذين كفروا لولا أنزل عليه آية من ربه قل إن الله يضل من يشاء ويهدي إليه من أناب.
My dear respected elders and brothers, last week we were speaking about the qualities of those great Muslims, those people who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises. They were those people who Allah ta'ala called Ulul Albab, and Allah ta'ala called them the smart ones. They were those yasiruna ma amrullahu bihi ayusan, those orders of Allah Ta'ala which are supposed to be established, they establish them. They don't break the covenant of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, and also they are afraid of the evil punishment and retribution on the day of Qiyamah. They are afraid, and that fear is the driving force behind them worshipping and obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have sabr as well, and their patience is exercised for only the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one other beautiful thing they do, and what is the hardest thing, is that they repel evil with goodness. If somebody does evil and bad to them, then they repel it and they give the reply with goodness, with good things. Allah ta'ala mentioned for them will be the end, the abode will be very great. Jannatu adni yadkhulunaha, and the reward will be that there will be gardens of bliss and gardens of foreverness that they will enter in, and not only them, wa man salaha min abaihim wa azwajihim, their forefathers, their wives and their children, even if those children and those forefathers and their wives were of a lower grade and they did not have the same iman and a'mal, and they were not up to par with them. Still, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we understand from other ayat, will raise them up and bring them towards the people who are of the higher darajat and higher levels, and will join the families together in this way. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about those who were against the deen of Allah ta'ala, وَالَّذِينَ يَنْقُذُونَ عَهْدَ اللَّهِ, those people who break the covenant of Allah ta'ala, and that is tawheed. That is when our ruh was told in the Alami Arwah, Alastu bi Rabbikum, and we said, Bala. We agreed with it. So every person who doesn't believe in Allah Ta'ala is actually breaking this natural feeling and this natural inclination that a person has to the oneness of Allah Ta'ala, he's breaking it. Wa yaqta'una ma amrullah, and they are opposite than those who are ulul albab. They break that which Allah Ta'ala has said to establish, and worse, it's not only amongst them, but it's transitive. They spread it amongst all other people. وَيُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ, and they spread mischief in the world. وَلَهُمُ اللَّعْنَةَ وَلَهُمْ سُوءُ الدَّارِ, Allah Ta'ala says, they will be punished. Al-la'na means al-bu'du min al-rahma, to be far from the mercy of Allah Ta'ala, and they will have a very evil punishment. The last ayat that we did last week, Allah Ta'ala ended off with the reason why these people are leading themselves towards the fires of Jahannam, and why they are disobeying Allah Ta'ala, because they think that the rizq, and the money that they have is due to the pleasure of Allah Ta'ala that's with them. They are materialists. The Mushrik in Mecca, they were materialists, meaning they thought that the money that they had and the riches and the good halat and conditions that they had, it was due to God being pleased with them. And this is a wrong notion. Allah Ta'ala says, Allahu yabsutu rizqa liman yasha'u wa yaqdir. Allah Ta'ala has no discrimination in regards to who He gives money to and who He doesn't. Allah Ta'ala says, He spreads out His sustenance and the rizq to whoever He wants, and also He holds it back to whoever He wants. وَفَرِحُوا بِالْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. And the terrible thing that's going on is that the mushrik in Mecca, those who are rejecting Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they are very arrogant in regards to the worldly life. They are thinking that since they have money, and since they have pomp, and they have leadership, and they have good positions, then God is, and Allah is actually happy with them, which is a wrong thought, and this aqidah is actually batil, and is worth nothing in the eyes of Allah Ta'ala. That's why وَفَرِحُوا بِالْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. They're very happy and arrogant and proud that they have gotten some things of dunya. Allah Ta'ala then says, وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا فِي الْآخِرَةِ. And compared, the worldly life compared to the hereafter, إِلَّا مَتَى. It's only a little bit of enjoyment. Mata is those products in the market that look very beautiful, but they actually break very fast. So that was last week what we did. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turns again back to the mushrik in Mecca, and one thing that they repeatedly did to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it was actually frustrating Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah ta'ala addresses it here in some of these ayat. Allah ta'ala says, وَيَقُولُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُ. Those who have disbelieved in Allah ta'ala, meaning Ahlul Mecca, the people of Mecca, they said, لَوْلَا أُنزِلَ عَلَيْهِ آيَةٌ مِّن رَبِّي. Why doesn't a miracle be sent down from their Lord, from His Lord? Why Rasulullah should not get some miracle? They were asking Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for different things. They were asking him that the asa of Musa, that the Jews claimed that Musa alayhi salam had, why doesn't he have that? How about Yadul Bayda? Why your hand is not glowing? What about the naqa that was given to the Anbiya of the past, the camel that was given to Salih alayhi salam? And all these different miracles, they kept asking Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for these things. And even more than that, we're going to do it later on, they were asking that why don't you raise the dead? And why don't the mountains walk with you? And different things they kept asking for, making these requests, and they would say that if you bring this, then we'll bring Iman. So Allah Ta'ala answers and He tells them, you tell them, O Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قُلْ. This is the reply you should give. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُذِلُّ مَن يَشَاءُ وَيَهْدِي إِلَيْهِ مَن أَنَابَ. This is not the way to get the guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People are not going to accept the Islam only because miracles would be given to you, O Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You tell them that Allah Ta'ala misguides whoever He wants. It could be such that the cane or the stick of Musa alayhi salam will be right in front of that person, and still he will be a disbeliever of Allah Ta'ala. The person who the cane or the asa, the stick and staff of Musa alayhi salam, the person who was put first in front of and it turned into a snake in front of, was Fir'aun. Did he accept Islam? No, he died as a non-Muslim. Musa alayhi salam's Yadul Bayda, it was pulled out and his hand was glowing right in front of the eyes of Fir'aun. He saw it glow and then he saw the light go away. Did Fir'aun come to Islam? No, he didn't. The camel of Salih alayhi salam was presented in front of his people. Not only did they reject it, but they ended up killing that camel, na'udhu billah. The camel coming out of the mountain, and they saw it with their own eyes. So Allah Ta'ala shows here that it is not about the miracles. He died, and guidance is actually one of the biggest miracles that is in a person's life. The fact that a person can become guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you tell them, O Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Allah Ta'ala guides whoever He wants. This is up to the mashiyat of Allah Ta'ala. It is up to the want of Allah Ta'ala, the desire of Allah Ta'ala. He will misguide whoever He wants. But in regards to guidance, There is a way that you can trigger the guidance of Allah Ta'ala. Allah Ta'ala says, وَيَهْدِي إِلَيْهِ مَنْ أَنَابْ. This is the beautiful karam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That in regards to idlal, in regards to misguidance, it's the mashiyah. You cannot control it. Allah Ta'ala misguides whoever He wants. But in regards to guidance, Allah Ta'ala opens up the door crack and says, just push the door and come on in, you'll be guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيَهْدِي إِلَيْهِ مَنْ أَنَابْ. And Allah Ta'ala guides to Himself. He guides He, man anab, who now turns towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anaba bit tawbah. The person now makes tawbah and he repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After repentance, then Allah Ta'ala enters the hidayah and the guidance in that person's heart. So Allah Ta'ala, in regards to guidance, is giving the mushrikeen Mecca, so to say, a sign and showing them that make inabat, turn to me, and then I will guide you. And if you don't, then you will be amongst those who are the mudil and those who have been misguided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After this, Allah ta'ala spends a couple of ayats explaining who these people are who do inabat and return to Allah ta'ala, and they pay attention to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and make the tawbah and make the repentance to Allah ta'ala and then get guidance from Him. Allah ta'ala says,
الذين آمنوا وتطمئن قلوبهم بذكر الله ألا بذكر الله تطمئن القلوب.
Allah Ta'ala says, the people who do inabat and the people who get guidance, they are those people, الذين آمنوا, those people first of all who believe. If you repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but you don't believe in Allah ta'ala after that, then repentance has no value in the eyes of Allah ta'ala. So the first thing a person must do, iman. They believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then after that, وَتَطْمَئِنُّ قُلُوبُهُمْ بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. And then their heart becomes content and satisfied with the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So first is iman. And then after that, a person, when he starts remembering Allah Ta'ala, his heart becomes satisfied with this. Because iman is not an easy thing. When a person says, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, there are a lot of things he's putting on his shoulders. He has to pray the salah. He has to stay away from sins. He has to pay his zakat. Brothers are going for hajj now. They are sacrificing their time, their money, sacrificing their health. So Islam has a lot of challenging things in it. But it's not such that Allah Ta'ala leaves you in a barren desert and leaves you out there with no water and leaves you out there in a desert or a forest all alone, that you have nowhere to go and now you are in worry all day. No. If you bring iman and you believe in Allah Ta'ala, Allah Ta'ala will now control your heart in such a way that He will put the contentment and the happiness in the heart. And you'd be surprised. This happiness is just by seeing this itminan al-qalb. Just by seeing this happiness of the heart, so many people, without even hearing the message of Islam, it brings them towards the masjid. I've dealt with many, many non-Muslims who have been brought to the masjid by Muslims who outwardly don't even look like a strong Muslim. But the people have told me that there's just something about Muhammad that everybody else is worried. Muhammad, Ismail, whoever it may be. So the non-Muslim tells me, there's something about Muhammad or Ismail or whoever it may be that everybody else is worried about what's going on. But whenever I talk to Muhammad, he says, Alhamdulillah. And his heart is, he doesn't worry about nothing. That he has, I want that. That's itminan al-qalb. That's why some of the ulama, they mention bidhikrillah actually means بِذِكْرِ وَعْدِ اللَّهِ, by hearing the promises of Allah Ta'ala. By Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He tells us that because of this virtue of iman, we're going to get Jannah. Because of your salat, Allah Ta'ala will take care of your sustenance. If you pray hajj, if you go for the hajj, Allah Ta'ala will forgive your sins and you will get Jannah. لَا جَزَاءَ لَهُ إِلَّا الْجَنَّةِ. The hajj mabroor. There is no reward for it except that that person goes straight to Jannah. Straight to Jannah. If you give the zakat, Allah Ta'ala will protect your money. All these wa'ada and these promises of Allah Ta'ala, then a person says, Alhamdulillah, I'm fine. My Allah Ta'ala will take care of me. But now the minute he moves away from that, then the heart starts getting worried. Which Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said under the ayat,
كَلَّا بَلْ رَانَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ مَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ.
Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned that when a person sins and moves away from the deen of Allah ta'ala and does not make an effort to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so nuqtatul sawda, a black dot comes on that person's heart. And if he does it again, and another sin, slowly but surely these black dots accumulate to such an extent that the whole heart then becomes enshrouded with this blackness. Allah ta'ala calls it ran, which means rust. The heart becomes rusted, and because of what the person did, now he moves away and has no type of itminan, and that's what we call what? Worry and depression. And in Urdu they call it what? Pareshani, right? The person starts getting worried. Now he's sitting somewhere and doesn't know what to do. So it is with the dhikr of Allah Ta'ala. So some of the ulama say the wa'ada, by listening to the wa'ada, by listening to the promises of Allah Ta'ala, our heart gets satisfaction about what we are doing. Some ulama say dhikrillah means the Qur'an. Because afdalu dhikr, the best dhikr is the Qur'an, tilawatul Qur'an. So some ulama say that by reading the Qur'an, a person gets itminan al-qalb. His heart becomes content. And not only contentment, but the person's heart becomes also protected. And not only protected, but even the person's health and his age and his body all become protected. That's why Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he mentions under the ayat where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ثُمَّ رَدَدَنَاهُمْ أَسْفَلَ سَافِرِينَ. That insan is such that we created him أحسن التقويم. The very greatest and beautiful creation is the insan. It is written in the books of history that one woman was once given talaq by her husband in a very terrible way, where the man said to her, if you are not more beautiful than the moon, then you are talaq three times. This woman went from alim to alim. She went to all of the ulama and she said, what should I do in regards to this talaq? Most of them told her that you have been talaq three times. Because the moon is such a beautiful thing. Even the sahaba compared the moon to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's face looked like the Badr, the 15th moon. So shiny it was. How could you be more beautiful than the moon? You are not more beautiful than the moon. So therefore your talaq is going to fall. So at last resort, this lady, she came to Imam Azam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. And when she told him this, Abu Hanifa, he told her that don't worry, go back to your husband, the talaq does not fall. She said, what do you mean? Oh, the ulama have told me that the talaq has fell. And you are the only one that's telling me that the talaq is not fell. He said, have you not heard the ayat that we have created insan ahsan al-taqweem? The most beautiful of all creation is the insan. You are even more beautiful than the moon. Therefore she left and she went back to her husband, and hopefully her husband did not give another dumb talaq after that again. And hopefully she didn't get him mad also. So the rest of the story, we don't know what happened to them. Some people say, what happened to them after? No, that's not part of the story. Ulama have not written that. The one who spoils the joke, right? You say the joke, the punchline, then the guy says, so what happened after that? The joke is finished after that. There's nothing else after that. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so I forgot where I was coming from with the creator. Oh, acha. So Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu has mentioned that ثُمَّ رَدَدَنَاهُمْ أَسْفَلَ سَافِلِينَ. Then we create them the lowest of the lowest. Which most of the ulama say that the person, the insan, even though they are the greatest of creation, they get the lowest of the lowest, meaning they go to Jahannam, na'udhu billah, where they become worse than the even animals. Because the animals on the day of Qiyamah will be turned to dust. And it's at that time where the person will wish in his heart that كُنْتُ تُرَابَ. The person who's who will not go to Jannah on that day, he will say, I wish I was dust also, just like the animals. So he will be worse than the animal in the way that he'll go to Jahannam. But Ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhu, who was Hibrul Ummah, and we call him Ra'is al-Mufassireen. He himself, from the Mubarak mouth of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, received the dua where Rasulullah told him, "Oh Allah, teach him the Quran and teach him the meaning of the Quran." Rasulullah made dua for Ibn Abbas with that. So Ibn Abbas's tafsirs, many times they differ from the regular normal tafsir that you will read. Ibn Abbas, in regards to this ayat, says that ثُمَّ رَدَدَنَاهُمْ أَسْفَلَ السَّافِلِينَ. أَسْفَلُ السَّافِلِينَ, the lowest of the low, means an age where a person becomes senile, which we call أَرْضِ الْعُمَرِ, where people become 80, 90 years old. And may Allah Ta'ala protect us, even the 60, 70 year olds these days, they get the Alzheimer's and these type of things. Where now an old person is not able to do their own istinja, they're not able to go to the bathroom by themselves, they cannot hear, they are dependent on someone. That age, Ibn Abbas says, is asfalu safilin. This is the worst of the worst. And then Allah Ta'ala says, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Ibn Abbas says the tafsir of this is, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ يَقْرَؤُونَ الْقُرْآنِ. Except for those people who read the Qur'an. If your habit in your life is to do tilawat of Qur'an and read the Qur'an profusely and a lot, then inshallah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will save you from reaching an old age where you're basina. And probably many of us, because most of you are born Muslims, you probably are thinking about relatives in your own family, old men in your own family, who their habit was to read the Qur'an constantly. That even some people will probably put their hand and say, "Relax, brother. Let's go eat. Stop reading the Quran. Give some time." But then you find those people at their old age, they're still so strong. They're still 70, 80 years old. They're still able to walk to the masjid by themselves. They're still able to cook their own food. We had one man who used to come to the masjid, read salat so much. When he was 70 years old, he's riding the bike to the masjid. Riding the bike. In the middle of the street, he's coming, he rides the bike, park his bike, and 70 years old, and he's riding the bike to the masjid. And he's coming reading Quran from all the way Fajr, up to Dhuhr, he's reading the Quran, after Dhuhr he will leave, then after again Asr to Maghrib, Maghrib to Isha, he's reading Tilawat of Quran, reading the Quran so much. So some ulama say, Tatma'in al-Qulub means that the heart becomes content with the Quran, the recitation of the Quran, the heart will become content. And of course, dhikr of Allah Ta'ala could mean regular dhikr. The remembrance of Allah Ta'ala, La ilaha illallah, Subhanallah, all the adhkar which Rasulullah has prescribed for us, we should try and do this. If we do this, then our heart will become content. And contentment of the heart is what the whole world is in search of right now. The drugs, the music, the sports, the cars, the money, whatever it may be, the music, all of it is in search for what? Contentment of the heart. And it will never be done except with the dhikr of Allah Ta'ala. That's why the sha'ir says that أَهْلُ اللَّيْلِ فِي لَيْلِهِمْ أَلَذُّ مِنْ أَهْلُ اللَّغْوِ مِنْ لَغْوِهِمْ فِي لَغْوِهِمْ. The people of the night, those people who are doing the dhikr of Allah Ta'ala at night, those who are worshipping Allah Ta'ala at night, the enjoyment, the itminan, the contentment of the heart that they get, it is much more enjoyable than those people who are sitting in the nightclubs with a bottle of champagne in their hand, with the women sitting around them, with the music blasting in their ears. Even though they seem to be enjoyment, and they seem to be having a nice time, but this poet, he says, أَهْلُ اللَّيْلِ فِي لَيْلِهِمْ. Those people of the night in tahajjud, doing the dhikr of Allah Ta'ala, them in the worship of the night, أَلَذُّ, they are enjoying more, it's more tasty, more enjoying than أَهْلُ لَغْوِ فِي لَغْوِهِمْ, than the people who are involved in baseless activities and wasting their time. So it is the dhikr of Allah Ta'ala which gives itminan. Then Allah Ta'ala says, Allah, this is for tanbih. Yani, agaho jaan. Listen, be aware, know. Bidhikrillahi tatma'in al-qulub. It is only with the dhikr of Allah Ta'ala that the heart can become content. You can run anywhere. فَأَيْنَ تَذْهَبُونَ. Where are you going to go? You can run to the 50 or 100 different other places. You will not find itminan al-qalb. Allah Ta'ala says, Allah, let it be known. Bidhikrillah. Actually, it's supposed to be tatma'in al-qulub bidhikrillah. But in the Arabic language, when you bring something forward, Yufidu tahsis or takhsis. It gives the benefit of specification. When we say in Surah Fatiha, Iyyaka na'budu, we actually are saying what? We worship only you. But Iyyaka na'budu actually means only you we worship. By bringing Iyyaka first, the word only comes in there. It wasn't na'budu Iyyaka. No. Iyyaka na'budu. We didn't say Iyyaka, we didn't say nasta'inu Iyyaka. No. Iyyaka, only you we worship, and only you we ask for help. The same thing here. Ala bi dhikrillah. Dhikrillah should come after tatma'in al-qulub, but Allah Ta'ala brings it first to show that this is the only rasta and the only pathway towards contentment of the heart. Ala bi dhikrillahi tatma'in al-qulub. Then Allah Ta'ala then mentions some other qualities of those who believe.
الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ طُوبَى لَهُمْ وَحُسْنُ مَآبٍ.
Allah Ta'ala says, they are those people who believe. Again, Iman. They believe. And also, وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, they have the good deeds as well. They have devoted their heart to Allah Ta'ala, and they have devoted jawarih. They have devoted their bodies to Allah Ta'ala as well. Both have to be there. If a person devotes his body and doesn't devote his heart, then that person's a munafiq. And the person who only devotes his heart and doesn't devote his body, then he's a sinner of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So both have to be there. The iman, the inside and the outside. The iman and the islam. Both of them have to be there.
طُوبَى لَهُمْ. Allah Ta'ala says طُوبَى لَهُمْ. طُوبَى لَهُمْ can have two meanings. طُوبَى لَهُمْ could also mean from طِيب, meaning حُسْنًا لَهُمْ, طِيبُ الْعَيْشِ,
they will have a good life. They will have a good life, a beautiful life in the hereafter they will have. And some of them say طُوبَى, in the hadith it comes, it is a tree that will be given to that person in Jannah. Some of the ulama say that this tree, its roots are in the qasr of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is in the palace of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the roots spread out and go to all the houses of the mu'mineen. And the tree is so big that if a person who's a raqib, a rider, a horse rider, not us. Of course, if we get on a horse, we'll go very slow. It'll take us 500 years just to pass by the trees over here. But those who ride well, a rider, if he rides fast for 500 years, he will not finish and come out of the shade of that tree, but yet the tree itself. So Allah Ta'ala says, طُوبَى لَهُمْ. And the tree, of course, when we get to Jannah, we will appreciate the tree. A person may have in his mind, might be thinking, that what the hell am I going to do with a tree that's 500 years big? Right? The tree in my back lawn, I'm trying to get it cut in the backyard. I'm trying to get it cut for the last 3 years, and the companies tell me it's so much, and this is, and I got to get a, you know, I got to tell the city, and what am I going to do with 500? Give me something else, 500, what am I doing with that? So Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran, عَرَّفَهَا لَهُمْ. When you get there, then you'll understand. Right? If you ask the baby in the womb what ice cream is, and we know our kids how they love ice cream, they won't appreciate it. They'll say this umbilical cord right here, this is my source. Just give me this, I'm happy. But then when they come out, after a couple of years they live here, give them ice cream, they love it. So in the same way, in this world, it's very hard for us to understand a tree of that enormous size, what benefits it will give. When we get there, inshallah, then we'll, and if you don't like it, when we get there, inshallah, you can give your tree to me, if you don't like it also.
طُوبَى لَهُمْ.
Allah Ta'ala says, that tree will be given to them.
وَحُسْنُ مَآبٍ.
And also they will have a beautiful result, a beautiful ending. Their abode will be so beautiful. The Jannah, everything that they have will be beautiful. Then after this, Allah Ta'ala says,
كَذَلِكَ أَرْسَلْنَاكَ فِي أُمَّةٍ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهَا أُمَمٌ لِتَتْلُوَ عَلَيْهِمُ الَّذِي أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ وَهُمْ يَكْفُرُونَ بِالرَّحْمَنِ قُلْ هُوَ رَبِّي لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ عَلَيْهِ تَوَكَّلْتُ وَإِلَيْهِ مَتَابٌ.
Allah Ta'ala then gives the nasiha and the advice to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That, O Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have sent you in this ummah. We have sent you amongst these Arab. You have a job to do. Stay focused.
كَذَلِكَ أَرْسَلْنَاكَ.
In this way we have sent you,
في أمّةٍ, in such a nation, قد خلت من قبلها أمم, that other nations have passed before them. The nation of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is such a nation that doesn't have, it's not that we are the only nation, but we have nations before us, which have passed before us, and we know about them. Right now this is the best time. The Hajj, everything is based on a nation before us, and that was the nation, Ummatu Ibrahim alayhi salam. The Nabi of Ibrahim alayhi salam. We are Ummat who knows about the nations before. So Allah Ta'ala says, قَدَ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهَا أُمَمُ. There were nations before them that passed also, and their Anbiya also went amongst them and made efforts as well. لِتَتْوَ عَلَيْهِمُ الَّذِي أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ. And your job, O Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that you may recite, so that you may recite upon them that which has been revealed to you. That's all your job is. Tilawat. Recite it to them. Tell them what the ayat and the verses of Allah Ta'ala are. وَهُمْ يَكْفُرُونَ بِالرَّحْمَانِ. But unfortunately, they are rejecting Ar-Rahman. They are rejecting Ar-Rahman. Ar-Rahman, why is it said here? We know that the Mushrikeen Mecca, they had an enmity against the name Rahman. They said, we believe in Allah, وَمَا الرَّحْمَانِ. But we don't know Rahman. We don't know. وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ اسْجُدُوا لِلرَّحْمَانِ قَالُوا وَمَا الرَّحْمَانِ. When Rasulullah would say, make sajda and prostrate to Rahman, they would say, وَمَا الرَّحْمَانِ. We don't know Rahman. Even in Sulh Hudaybiyah, when Rasulullah mentioned that he was a Rasul, and he wrote, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, they said, wipe out Rasul, wipe out Rahman. We don't know about this. We know about Allah, we know about Muhammad, we don't know about Rasul. If this, we knew your Rasul, we won't be signing this. And Rahman, that's your Lord, it's not our Lord. So they were rejecting Rahman. So Allah Ta'ala mentions it here. وَهُمْ يَكْفُرُونَ بِالرَّحْمَانِ. They are such that they are rejecting this name of Rahman, Allah Ta'ala. But don't worry about it, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You tell them that قُلْ هُوَ رَبِّي. Say that Rahman, it is my Lord. You tell them that Rahman is my Lord. There's no other Rahman. This is my Lord, لا إله إلا هو, and there's no Lord other than Him. عليه توكلت. I will keep giving you da'wah of this Rahman and this Allah, because why? عليه توكلت. Upon Him I rely. I depend upon Him. وإليه متاب. And to Him is our return. And to Him is the repentance. We will repent only to Him. We will not turn to anybody else. After this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions an ayat which has been revealed because the people came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they told Rasulullah and they requested him that, O Rasulullah, please move the mountains and bring rivers flowing next to it, and our forefathers who have died, resurrect them for us. Bring them back to them. These are the things they were asking Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which in the beginning ayat we did already. So these were some specific things that they asked. Allah Ta'ala in reply to this, He mentions,
وَلَوْ أَنَّ قُرْآنًا سُيِّرَتْ بِهِ الْجِبَالُ أَوْ قُطِّعَتْ بِهِ الْأَرْضُ أَوْ كُلِّمَ بِهِ الْمَوْتَى بَلْ لِلَّهِ الْأَمْرُ جَمِيعًا أَفَلَمْ يَيْأَسِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْ لَوْ يَشَاءُ اللَّهُ لَهَدَى النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا وَلَا يَزَالُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا تُصِيبُهُمْ بِمَا صَنَعُوا قَارِعَةٌ أَوْ تَحُلُّ قَرِيبًا مِنْ دَارِهِمْ حَتَّى يَأْتِيَ وَعْدُ اللَّهِ إن الله لا يخلف الميعاد.
Allah Ta'ala says, لو أن قرآنا. If there was a book, Allah Ta'ala says قرآنا. He didn't say Al-Quran. Because most of the Mufassirin say that Quran doesn't mean Al-Quran here. It means any book. If Allah Ta'ala was to give any book to you, O Nabi Islam, if there was a book that was given to you, and that book, سُيِّرَتْ بِهِ الْجِبَالِ. Because of that book, the mountains were starting to make move. The mountains were moved through that book. Because of that book, the mountains moved. أَوْ قُطِّعَتْ بِهِ الْأَرْضِ. Or the earth was split open because of that book, and now the earth started bringing out rivers and the rivers started flowing. أو كلم به الموتى, or the dead people through that book began to start speaking. Meaning, they were resurrected and they started speaking. So, O Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even if we gave you such a book, they would still not believe. Allah Ta'ala doesn't mention it here. The word lo in the beginning is what we call shart. It's a conditional word. And any shart needs what we call a jawab, it needs a reply. For example, if I told you, if you come to Hamza Masjid on Friday, and I stop there, I don't say anything else. So you're going to tell me, what then? What? What do you? What if I come? What's going to happen? Then I said, then you'll learn tafsir after Isha. Right? You'll learn tafsir. This is what we call jawab in Arabic. But sometimes Allah Ta'ala leaves this out when it's known. When it's known. Like if a person asked me, that Mu'mikil, is the tafsir class beneficial if you come on Friday? Right? Leave it out, right? If you come on Friday, you'll learn about this. I know it's going to be corny. If you come on Friday, anticipation. Or it's known already. Yes, the class is good, of course, it benefits Tafsir al-Quran. Everyone benefits from Tafsir al-Quran. Even if we sit here and read one book about Tafsir al-Quran, we'll benefit. So here, because it's known, we know that these people, they want guidance to this. They're saying that, do this for us, we'll get guided. So Allah Ta'ala says to Nabi Islam, if there was a book, and that book was making the dead people talk, and that book was making rivers flow, and that book was moving the mountains, they still would say that, no, there's some type of magic. No, forget it. They wouldn't believe in Allah Ta'ala. So therefore, don't worry about this, O Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And Rasulullah, of course, was getting sad from this, and also the Muslims, unfortunately, they started also, some of the Sahaba started thinking that, oh Allah, in their heart it came, that Ya Allah, bring one of these miracles, then inshallah they'll believe. Then let them just give them something. So when Allah Ta'ala knew that the Muslims started feeling this, so Allah Ta'ala then said, أَفَلَمْ يَيْأَسِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. أَفَلَمْ يَيْأَسِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Those people who believe, don't they know? Don't they know? Yayas actually means to be despondent, to be hopeless. So some ulama say yayas here means ya'lamu. Ya'lamu. Because a person who is hopeless of something, he knows that it will not happen. So therefore yayas sometimes has the meaning of ya'lam. So it means actually afalam ya'lamu. Don't they know? Don't they know that these people won't bring iman? Don't they know that these people will not believe? So that's why Allah says, أَفَلَمْ يَيْسَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Don't those who believe not know? لَوْ يَشَاءُ اللَّهُ. That if Allah Ta'ala wanted, لَهَدَى النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. He could have guided everybody all at once. If Allah Ta'ala wanted, He can, not even the snap of a finger, not even the blink of an eye. Before that, the whole world could be Muslim, all the houses could become masjids. If Allah Ta'ala wanted to do it. So, oh Muslims, why are you now thinking like this? And why are you saying that? Give them some miracles so they can, it don't need that to get guidance. I told you already, I'm the one who guides. And it's not dependent on some giving some miracle. If you're thinking that, then you're thinking they give the guidance. Then Allah Ta'ala mentions about those who disbelieve and those who now have done this to Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Allah Ta'ala says, وَلَا يَزَالُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا تُصِيبُهُمْ بِمَا سَنَعُوا قَارِعًا. That these people keep making these replies and they keep asking these things from Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They're not doing it and there's going to be no result from it. Allah Ta'ala says that the people who disbelieve, they will continuously being تُصِيبُهُمْ. It will come continuously upon them. Bima sana'u, because of that which they've done. Qari'atun, an affliction. Qari'a means a punishment. Some type of musibah, some affliction, it will continue to come on them because of what they keep doing to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by asking him to bring these different miracles. أو تحلوا قريبا من دارهم. Or, there's two tarjumas of this, two tafsirs of this. تحلوا can go back to qari'a. Or a punishment will come close to their houses. punishment will come very close to their house, where they'll become very scared. Or tahullu can go to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Or Nabi sallam, you will come very close to their houses with your army, and you will take them as prisoners, and you will take the Fatwa Mecca, and this is a source of punishment for them also. Because Allah Ta'ala, with the Ahlul Mecca, He didn't open up the ground and swallow them, but the Hudaybiyah, the Badr, the Fatwa Mecca, all of these wars, these were actually their punishment. This was the punishment that Allah Ta'ala gave them, that they lost the wars to the Muslims. So Allah Ta'ala says, it could be such that, O Nabi Islam, your army will come close to them, hatta ya'ti wa'adullah, until the promise of Allah Ta'ala comes to pass, and that is the victory that Allah Ta'ala will give you, and it happened. Hudaybiyah happened, and then Fathu Mecca took place a few years after. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُخْلِفُ الْمِعَادِ. Verily, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He does not go against His promise. After this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives some more tasalli and some more, consolement on Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then talks a little bit about Jannat and the fire of Jahannam, and then so at the ending, Allah ta'ala talks a little bit more about how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has to know that the decisions are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah, from the ruku, we will start from there next week inshallah, and we'll try to finish up this surah, because some of the ayats, mashallah, are so beautiful, we spend a little time on it, but inshallah soon we'll finish this surah by next week or the week after, probably before Eid, and then inshallah Ibrahim will start after Eid inshallah. Jazakallah khair wa akhu da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.